Jakarta, one of the world's largest megacities, is fastly disappearing into the sea. The capital of Indonesia has over 10 million people and about 30 million in its metropolitan area. By 2030, the city is predicted to take over Tokyo as the world's largest megacity. Jakarta is one of the busiest coastal cities, located on the northwest coast of Java. With issues of pollution, congestion, and frequent flooding, Jakarta is one of the most rapidly sinking cities in the world. It's sinking at a rate faster than many megacities on the planet. By 2050, scientists predict that one-third of Jakarta will be under the sea. Currently, 40% of the city sits below sea level. Jakarta's land has dropped by around 4 meters in the last 30 years. According to research, South Jakarta has the lowest sinking of 1 centimeter, followed by Central Jakarta sinking at 2 centimeter every year. East Jakarta is sinking by 10 cm and West is sinking up to 15 cm. North has the highest sinking rate of 25 cm. The city's sinking is more visible in North Jakarta. It is one of the worst affected areas, home to 1.8 million people. North Jakarta is close to the Java Sea, where the land has sunk to about 2.5 meters in 10 years. This area is surrounded by poor fishing communities, fading businesses, and industrial ports. Due to its low elevation, sea walls are built around the Java Sea to help keep the water away. The people living here regularly deal with floods and storm surges. Researchers predict that 95% of North Jakarta will sink by 2050. The city's location plays a prominent role in the sinking issue. Jakarta lies on a low swampy land prone to frequent flooding. It has 13 low-lying rivers flowing through the city. This is no surprise why the city easily floods. Jakarta experiences a tropical monsoon climate with an extended wet and short dry seasons. Even a short amount of rainfall can build up water and flood quickly. Floods are like an annual event in Jakarta. In 2007, a major flood submerged 75% of the city and displaced over 400,000 people. The city's average elevation is only 8 meters above sea level. However, parts of the city are already under the sea. For example, North Jakarta sits 1.5 meters below sea level. The concrete walls built around the Java Sea are the only barriers keeping the water from drowning the nearby coastal settlements. Like many coastal cities, Jakarta is experiencing a sea level rise due to climate change impacts. Global temperature rise causes glaciers to melt, and as a result, seawater expands and many low-lying coastal areas risk going underwater. In 1990, oceans were rising 0.6 mm, but currently they are rising 6 mm every year. This put many coastal cities, including Houston, Shanghai, and Lagos, at a risk of sinking. Besides rising sea level issues, the main reason for Jakarta's sinking comes from man-made causes of groundwater extraction. For decades, excessive pumping of groundwater caused the city's elevation to drop, making the land sink at a faster rate. Whereas sea level rise only intensifies the already sinking problem in Jakarta. Jakarta's rapid development of tall buildings, shopping centers, and hotels encourages the over-extraction of groundwater. This activity causes land subsidence in Jakarta. Land subsidence is a steady settling of land surface due to variations beneath the ground. Jakarta goes through four different land subsidence issues. They are over-extraction of groundwater, construction of buildings, natural consolidation of alluvial soil, and tectonic subsidence. But Jakarta's groundwater extraction is the main reason behind its rapid sinking. Land subsidence happens when a great amount of groundwater has been extracted from certain types of rock. Since water is partly responsible for holding the ground up, the rock falls apart and the soil compacts when groundwater is extracted excessively. In Jakarta, lax regulation allows almost anyone to carry out groundwater extraction. 60% of people in Jakarta rely on groundwater as the primary water source. That's because the centralized pipe water system is expensive and unavailable in many regions. Most water consumers come from low and middle income residents for whom pipe water sources are not affordable. So people extract water from illegal boreholes since water can be extracted without paying for it. Many unregistered wells are harder to find in Jakarta. This makes it difficult for government authorities to calculate the exact amount of groundwater extraction and ban it. Moreover, pipe water supply is mainly concentrated in wealthier regions, but this doesn't stop richer neighborhoods and businesses who can afford pipe water supply from using groundwater. They install their own powerful water pumps to extract deep groundwater and disconnect from the pipe supply. This causes further land subsidence, leading to flooding and contamination of water sources in poorer neighborhoods. The inequalities in water supply date back to the Dutch colonial era in Jakarta. In the 1600s, when the Dutch arrived in Jakarta's port town, they initially built a city that resembled Dutch architecture of townhouses and canals. The city was named Batavia, which is now known as Jakarta. The Dutch segregated native people based on racial and class divisions to influence Dutch dominance. During the colonization, when the canals weren't properly maintained, the water was contaminated and diseases like cholera and typhoid spread. So the Dutch moved towards the south and built a new colonial center. Since the canals were damaged, the Dutch were concerned about the water supply. Therefore, in the 1870s, the Dutch introduced the first centralized pipe water system for clean and safe water. But the pipe water system was only concentrated in the European households and intentionally ignored native houses. So only a narrow section of European housing was given access to piped supply. The natives had to depend on street vendors and damaged canals to get their water needs. This unequal access to pipe water supply in Jakarta created segregation within the city. This today resembles how many households, mainly the poorer ones, still lack pipe water supply. Like many developing cities, Jakarta urbanized rapidly and the population grew. Due to high population density, the city lacks space. This caused a shift in housing types built in Jakarta. High-rise towers are now replacing traditional low-rise buildings, but the weight of the taller buildings puts heavy pressure on the ground that's already collapsing into the sea. Water storage areas like wetlands, rivers, and lakes are needed to recharge groundwater and stop the ground from sinking. With the increased demand for housing, several water catchment areas are turned into buildings. Although Jakarta is surrounded by water and gets heavy monsoon rainfall, space to recharge groundwater is very limited. Therefore, freshwater supply has declined over the years. The rivers are heavily polluted with wastewater and domestic sewage, making them insufficient for consumption. Rivers supply only 2.2% of total water demand, mainly from Krukut River, while others are too polluted to use. 75% of wastewater is released into the rivers. The city's only wastewater treatment plant is situated in central Jakarta. The plant can only treat 2% of the wastewater. The lack of freshwater supply is another reason people rely heavily on groundwater. From 2000 to 2010, the Jakarta spatial plan decreased green spaces to accommodate built-up areas. This plan converted green spaces into housing settlements and shopping malls. By 2013, Jakarta was left with only 9% of green spaces compared to 29% in 2007. Sea dikes are built to protect Jakarta from floodwaters. The walls are temporary protection, but also a false sense of security because the water often seeps through walls and floods the nearby areas during a storm surge. 20 kilometers of seawalls are built around the Jakarta Bay, and further seawalls are planned as the first attempt to protect the city from drowning. Today, these concrete walls block the sea view from the land. $42 billion giant seawall is planned along Java Sea, expected to be completed by 2025. The wall will cover 32 kilometers long and help keep the city from flooding and rising sea levels. However, many researchers believe a giant sea wall will not benefit the city long term if land subsidence doesn't stop. As the city sinks, seawalls that are planned to prevent flooding will also sink. The government planned to move the capital city to relieve Jakarta. The new capital is named Nusantara. It will be built in East Kalimantan, located 1,300 km from Jakarta. The new capital city is planning to be eco-friendly. However, many critics point out the adverse environmental effects of constructing a new city, because it could risk the culture and environment of East Kalimantan, which is home to Borneo's rainforest and endangered species. The entire relocation is planned to be done by 2045, where only the administrative part of Jakarta is moving to the new capital, and a smart metropolis is planned to attract global talent to the new city. What happens to residents left behind is still uncertain, because for most residents, it could be unaffordable to move. As land subsidence cannot be reversed, there are still ways to slow the sinking rate in Jakarta. During the last century, Tokyo had a huge problem with land subsidence. After World War II, the economic activity grew with an overload of heavy buildings and vast amounts of groundwater extraction. But the government issued regulations in a step-by-step approach to banning groundwater extraction. The city switched to pipe water supply and other water sources to stop land subsidence. The city started using water-saving technologies, water recycling, and rainwater. Similar strategies can be applied in Jakarta, which is to ban groundwater and replace it with other water sources. The mayor of North Jakarta planned to ban groundwater extraction in the region from 2023. Since many areas still lack pipe water infrastructure, the government plans to install and supply clean water. However, a ban on groundwater extraction is not known in other regions in Jakarta. More than half of the people in Jakarta depend on groundwater because it's the most accessible water source. So, to replace groundwater, the government has the challenge of providing a clean, affordable, and easily accessible water source. As Jakarta receives high annual rainfall, improved water management and recycling practices could restore fresh water. Moreover, reforestation can recharge groundwater and reduce flooding and drought conditions. Mangroves could be used as a natural defense on the coastlines. They could limit over 15% of damage caused by waves and floods. But the only existing mangroves are located in west of Jakarta, where over 93% have been destroyed by construction and plastic waste. Restoring mangroves could help tackle the sea level rise in few parts of Jakarta. The government needs to revise the planning policies and land use methods. Improved water management system in Jakarta could slow down the sinking. If land subsidence isn't stopped, many parts of Jakarta will be underwater by 2050. If you enjoyed watching the video, please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next one.